Please welcome Robert Hunsicker for U.S. Congress from Washington's Congressional District 8, which is in, it travels from Western Washington all the way to Eastern Washington. So Sammamish, Auburn, Issaquah, and then crossing the mountains over to Wenatchee and Chelan and Ellensburg. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's a huge district. Touches all the way, even going the other way down to Tacoma.
That's right. That's right. All the way to the Puyallup tribal reservation lands.
Yes.
So it's all connected in Tacoma. And you currently work in tech, and you come from a working class background. Is that correct?
Yeah. So I'm what's known as a user experience designer. I create interfaces and make them easier for people to use. I come from both a tech and a design background, a little bit of video production as well.
Okay. And does that set you apart at all from the other candidates in your race?
Yeah. So the other candidates in my race are either doctors, lawyers, or millionaires or lobbyists. And we have a lot of those in Congress right now. Basically, people who can afford to not work and run a campaign because they have the means.
Absolutely. And so tell us a little bit about what the issues are, your biggest issues, the ones you're working on that are most important to you.
Well, as somebody who's been with Wolfpack and has been an activist for a while, the biggest thing for me is having money in politics. The corrupting influence of money in politics, you could say, is the root of all evil, the sin that makes it so we can justify everything else, and why over the years, you know, there's a Harvard study that shows that for the average person, there's a 30% chance that something that they like will happen, that's popular among the majority of people, and a 30% chance that things will not happen, or things that will happen that are unpopular with people. So it doesn't matter how popular it is with folks, there's a 30% chance it'll happen unless you're in the top 1%, and then there's a 60% chance of the things you favor happening. And that's not a democracy, and that's all because of money and politics. And we won't get Medicare for all, and people are going to continue to die because they don't have health care, or the health care they have is like what I have, where in a gig economy, I'm a contractor. I have to jump from job to job. I haven't had steady insurance, and I've gone long periods without insurance because that's the system we live in, which means I don't have a general practitioner. I don't have a regular person I can see just for checkups, which is the best way to prevent disease and stop people from dying. A lot of people brought up the NRA lately. They aren't the only gun lobbyists, and there's so much money that is going to that and military contracts, and that's why we have all these other things going on.
Absolutely. And so you worked with Wolfpack, and was there success in Washington with that?
There has been. We got very close last year, or the last session around, and we learned that we had to switch Congress because the people who were supporting Wolfpack were in the minority, and those were the Democrats at the time. So now, with the election of Minka Dinkrich, with Wolfpack organized and got boots on the ground to go door knock and help, along with her regular grassroots folks, we were able to help get her elected. And she committed to us beforehand that she supported the amendment. So the goal of Wolfpack, for those who don't know, is to do a state convention. So you have to have 35 states ratify it, and then you have a convention, and you can get an amendment to the Constitution and bypass Congress. The nice thing is, in the past, when things have gotten close to the stage we're at now, Congress has decided, well, there's enough public pressure, we're going to try and swoop in and be the heroes and take credit for it and pass it anyway, because they know it's likely to pass. Okay. So that could very well happen. There's a bunch of states in Wolfpack that Wolfpack are pushing towards that are just about there. And Washington is we've been fighting hard to get this in the session this time around.
Oh, that's exciting. And since you've been endorsed by the Washington Bureaucrats Coalition, now an Our Revolution group, to me that indicates you're pretty progressive, pretty left. And yes. So are there any surprises about how you feel about healthcare for all, Medicare for all?
No, I'm a big advocate. I think it's the only way to go. It's definitely a lot more affordable, and the outcomes are better. It's the most popular program in the United States for a reason. People who go on Medicare don't go, oh, I miss my private insurance I used to have. No, it's a much better system. You get full coverage. I'd like to take it a step further, though, and expand it to make sure all needs are covered. So mental health care coverage, dental health care coverage. Some of that is covered with Medicare, but I want it to be more expansive. And we need to retract that you can't negotiate drug prices with Medicare. That's ridiculous. Canada can do it with our drugs. It's...
You want to take the good idea of Medicare for all and make it better.
Yeah, yeah. No matter what, it's already way better than what we have.
Yes. And then you're also an anti-interventionist war candidate.
Yes. So
is that the same as a pro-peace candidate?
Yes, yes. There's no way to achieve peace unless you try peace. And right now, even if you're not a pro-peace person, you can still be anti-interventionist just because of the fact that you can look at the facts and say, we are less safe than we were when we started all these wars. Our resources are stretched thin, and more innocent people are being killed than the people who we're scared of. And I use that in quotes because that is a broad term depending on who you talk to. And there's a lot of racial tones in that and Islamophobic tones in that that are what are fueling the fire. And if we draw back and we actually don't try and police the world, we can approach things from a diplomatic place that will keep everybody safer, including the United States.
Well, what will our soldiers do?
what is better for them? They can keep us defensively protected. If we need them, you know, we have them and we can use that. But we didn't used to have a standing armory. You know, that's a fairly new development in U.S. history, let alone the biggest army in the world by leaps and bounds.
Right. Well, and then, so you have, I think, anti-war and healthcare for all and anti-corruption.
Yes.
Those are the big headlines that are pretty common among progressives. Are there any, you mentioned universal public child care.
Yeah, universal public child care is not a new idea, but it's been put on the back burner for a while. So it was part of the original feminist movement, and it actually got into, a bill was made and we were so close to it, and then Nixon vetoed it. And it's something that would lift up the American worker. Just think of how many of us grew up in families where childcare was always an issue. Working families where both parents have to work in order to make ends meet. Where do they put their kids before they're in school? What do they do? And childcare has become increasingly expensive, and just like Medicare for All, with worse outcomes. Overcrowded facilities, neglectful facilities, or if you want to avoid that, just you too expensive facilities. There's some parents who work multiple jobs just so they can afford childcare. And that shouldn't be the system we live in today. And we need to take care of our kids because the foundation of who they become happens when they're children. And we need to solidify that they have all the resources they need to be the best that they can be and be productive members of our society.
Absolutely. Thank you. And then you also have talked about a livable wage connected to tied to inflation.
Yeah. So there's 63% of Americans support a $15 minimum wage. And I think the problem with that is that it would be a higher supportage if it was a livable wage, because we won that fight here in Seattle area, but it's $15 minimum wage isn't a livable wage in Seattle. It might be in Kansas, but it's not here. And if you do things based on cost of living and you make it a livable wage that people can survive on is your minimum, and you do that per region, then you're meeting people's basic needs, especially if you do Medicare for All and a guaranteed jobs program along with that. So a livable wage is determined by things like cost of living, you know, the tax infrastructure, and the availability of transportation. So what is it that you need for where you are to where the jobs are? That we need fast. And if you tie it to inflation, it's always evaluated. So that way it's not just, oh, we set the living wage for now, like we do with our minimum wage. But then as inflation goes and people need more money, they're not updating that. So if it's tied to inflation, it gets kind of auto updated as the needs grow.
Excellent. And so when you, I've been following your race, and I noticed one of your opponent, or your, the, I wouldn't say opponent, necessarily.
Opponent's a safe word.
Okay, opponent. well, it's not like a Republican opponent. Yeah. It's from amongst other candidates in your, you know, but yes, your opponent. I heard one of them state that $15 an hour might be good for Seattle, but it's too much for Wenatchee and Ellensburg. And my instant thought was $15 an hour might be perfect for Ellensburg and Wenatchee, but yeah, it's a low bar for Seattle. And so you're not born and raised in this district, but there are a couple people in this district that were. And I wonder if maybe your exposure has made you better prepared for this.
Yeah, so let me address a couple things there. So I would say opponent because of the fact that I'm not running to make it blue no matter who. I'm not here to say Democrats need to take the seat. The reason I got into this race is because we need to have uncorrupted candidates. And there's so many people who have that D in front of their name who are voting against the interests of the people. It's not just Republicans. So anybody who votes against the interests of the people or speaks against the interests of the people, those are opponents. And if we look at it any other way, we're going to just get the worst people in office and keep them in office. There's a reason why Dianne Feinstein is not popular even among people on the left. She's basically a Republican with a D in front of her name. And to the next piece is, I think the reason that mindset of $15 an hour is too much for rural communities is because we have no infrastructure set up to support the small businesses who can't actually pay that $15 an hour right now until it starts getting into the system. You know, study after study shows that once you do the $15 an hour, or whenever you increase the minimum wage, the local businesses get the biggest boost. But it's also those local businesses that struggle the most at the beginning and they raise their prices. So as long as we put together a support system for those small local businesses, and so that way they don't have to close shop or whatever to support that until that money gets back into the system, into the local economy, then yes, $15 an hour is completely doable, but we have to help. We can't just throw it on the people who can't do it. Obviously, most of the jobs come through large corporations who can't afford it, but not all companies can afford it right now, and we need to look out for them as well.
Excellent. That's very important. I have a lot of friends who are small business owners who know the benefits of a higher minimum wage or a livable wage, but they're overwhelmed with the idea of the impact it'll create on their own business.
Yeah. And I've owned a small business before. It was an independent business when the recession hit. It was my only option at the time. And I know how hard some of these businesses struggle just to make ends meet. And we also need to have public financing banks that can help these small businesses to start off, so they're not forced into, you know, these crazy loans that no reasonable person can afford. If you already have the money and you don't need the loan, then you can afford those loans. And that's just a backward system. We need to support these businesses because they contribute so much to local economies and just the local well-being of the people who live there.
Well, I have to admit that having brought up the contrast between you and one of your other opponents, I it's like scratching the scab off, and now it's just bleeding. I also noticed another opponent mentioned private. I should have mentioned this earlier with healthcare, but mentioned privatizing the VA. Here, the left is struggling to socialize all of healthcare, and you've got a candidate in your race promoting the privatization of our military veterans' healthcare.
And it's not the Republican.
No.
This is what I'm talking about. Just because you're running with a for a D spot doesn't mean you are a Democrat. It doesn't mean that you are on the left. If you promote things like privatizing things that shouldn't be for profit, then you're not here for the people. You're here for the companies. You're here for the corporations. If you're mentioning that, that means you're probably either getting or trying to get money from industries that would benefit from that.
Well, but maybe it was someone who didn't know much about government or healthcare. Was it one of maybe the self-made millionaires or the lobbyists in the race?
No, it was a doctor.
Was it a doctor that knew anything about military healthcare?
Yeah, somebody who worked for the CDC.
Oh, that's devastating. And thank you for riding the roller coaster of finger pointing with Courtney. I'm overwhelmed sometimes. Is there any other favorite point that you enjoy talking about in your race without pointing a finger or with pointing a finger?
Well, yes, there's lots of points that you can make, and there's a lot of things that come up when I do events with the other candidates that are cringeworthy. A lot of them do have to happen over healthcare. And I will say, the thing I've noticed since I've been in the race and I've been attending these Democratic functions is they're pulling our way. I think they can see which way the winds are blowing, and they're trying to appeal to the people. When we started doing this, the terms access to healthcare, which is a Republican talking point, not Medicare for all, but we need to get everybody access to affordable healthcare. That's a way of saying that, you know, we're going to put things out there. They may not be good. They'll be affordable, but from who? Everybody will have access to it. As Bernie said during one of his Medicare town halls, everybody has access to a Lamborghini, but not everybody can afford a Lamborghini.
That's right.
And yes, they are affordable, but not to everybody. To the majority of people, they can't afford that. It's just trickery with words. And I've noticed that kind of stuff. And there's a lot of coaching involved. I will say I was happy to hear people's responses on NRA, just because I know the Democratic Party is trying to squash that from the candidates who are running because they're too afraid to lose. And that's the biggest thing I've noticed is in districts like mine that are purple, they haven't learned anything. They're still trying to run candidates like Republican light. And the more they stray from that and go to the left, the more they try and rein people in or ignore them. Like even Jason's much further right than any of us, as far as I'm concerned. And I've heard from a certain somebody that I'm even left of Bernie Sanders, so we'll put that in perspective.
When you say he's right of most of us, are you talking about the Progressive Washington crew, the candidate?
Yes, yeah, okay. Yeah, of us on the line here.
Yeah, and yet he's considered the most left aside from you, I'd say.
Yes, and the further he goes left, the more I've noticed the people who are more towing the line of the DNC and the DCCC don't want him in anymore, which is a worrying sign. just because he was one of the favorites at the beginning. But now they're playing the, we need to elect a female candidate. And we have so many amazing female candidates in this race. You showed a picture earlier that just highlighted three amazingly strong female congressional candidates. And yes, we need more female representation in Congress, but we don't need more conservative female representation in Congress, because that still doesn't represent us. Right. We need people who are going to represent the people. We need people who are going to support things like CFAR, which just lists, and they have polling data that shows all these platforms that are amazingly popular with the majority of people, including Republicans. And if you were to sign that, then you're showing you're standing for the people and that you're holding yourself to account. And all the candidates that were in that picture have signed that. And that is an amazing and beautiful thing. And we need that. You know, it includes things like the minimum wage, the $15 minimum wage. It includes things like improving the voter or the free trade agreements like NAFTA. It includes cutting back on military spending, because we're just throwing that money everywhere. And these are things that are majority approved by everybody. And that is beautiful. And we need to do that. We need to not go against the will of the people. That is not what we were raised America to be.
That's right. Well, thank you, Robert. Brian, are there any questions from our wonderful chat room?
Well, I actually had a question.
And okay.
As a stay-at-home dad, I'm curious to know a bit more about the child care assistance that you're talking about, and what we can do to either enact it or implement it or help to get that going.
So we'd have to create a new bill, a new legislation, and the Child Care Act, I'd love to be the first to write that up. And whether elected or not, I'd be happy to write that up and hand that off to any of our candidates. And essentially, it would guarantee, just like Medicare for All, it would guarantee child care, reliable, safe child care with qualified professionals that is not based on a profit motive, that any American can go to, rich or poor. Universal. Everybody has access to it, and it should be in every single district, every single precinct. So it doesn't matter if you're in a rural community, it doesn't matter if you're in an urban community, and that it should be based on per capita. So obviously in the city, you would need a lot more than you would need in a rural community, but it should cover everybody, and it should be based on, you know, child care professionals optimizing it for the children, to know exactly how many children per child care person, that kind of thing.
Yeah, and that's great.
The beauty is, it would, how many jobs would that create? Just think of how many jobs that would create for the child care industry and social work industry.
Right.
That's right. And being government jobs, then they aren't just jobs, they're livable wage jobs. Those are jobs with benefits.
Yes. Full benefits, full government benefits. And the one thing we'd have to figure out is just because of government holidays, not everybody gets those. Mm-hmm. But outside of that, it would be just a perfect system for everybody. How many families would get lifted up if they no longer had to work two jobs to cover the cost of their childcare? And I believe Courtney's mentioned this before. We could even extend something like this, so that way parents who elect to be the child care professional could be brought into that and be paid for that work, because that is work. That means the money that we would be going to the kids now can be going.
That sounds really good.
Yeah.
Oh, I
would
love
definitely
that.
Like to learn more about that in the future. But okay. Yeah, I think we got to get...
Yeah, for everybody who's interested, if you go to voterobertHunsaker.com, I do have an article on my site that goes over that in detail.
And I want to sit here for a moment and call Rhonda out. She likes to put an NG in your name, but it's Hunsaker with a K.
Oh, it's not just the G. I throw in T's in there and yeah. K. I mean,
the whole alphabet.
All the time, whether I say it wrong or spell it wrong. I think I got the spelling down now. But thank you, Robert, so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
We really appreciate a fresh, just a voice that needs to be heard, so we can make some changes here in Washington State.
Thank you.
In Washington, D.C.